was told by the doctors I had cancer. I went into hospital for an immediate operation. Then I went to convalesce in Bournemouth with Florence as a nurse. Since 1932, I'd been working by request of the Air Ministry on a day and night fighter to replace the outdated fighters then in use with the RAF.
Essential requirements are 1. Low landing speed and short landing run. 2. Maximum speed of 250 miles per hour. 3. Steep initial climb rate for interception. 4. High maneuverability. 5. Good all-round view. No specific shape of airframe called for, but fighter to be armed with 4 Vickers machine guns. Thank you.
Well, 250 mile per hour was dead easy. We flew a prototype in February 1934. A monoplane with a narrow streamlined fuselage, an open cockpit, powered by a Rolls-Royce Goshawk 2 engine. Twin-bladed propeller, fixed undercarriage and trousered wheels. But generally its performance fell below what was specified. She had something, but, well, I knew I could do better. Sir Robert McLean, the chairman of Vickers, nicknamed her the Spitfire, something he called his little daughter because of her temper tantrums. The Spitfire. Bloody silly name, I thought, but it stuck all the way through its further developments. All through 1935, I developed the fighter. I was so taken with her, and with the fear that if the cancer returned, I wouldn't see it through. In 1936, the new fighter was ready for its first test flight. And on the afternoon of March the 5th, it flew. And it was magical.
RAF Fighter Command never had more than 700 serviceable aircraft, and in 1940 most pilots had no combat experience. It was a hot, sunny summer. The fighter planes were endlessly serviced and checked. July 16th is considered as the start of the Battle of Britain, when Hitler issued his directive to smash the RAF to clear the way for his invasion fleets. It finished in late October, but it had no really clear ending. The prime targets of the Germans were the airfields and the aircraft factories, but they also included ports and harbours. From the numbers of aircraft involved, the odds were in the enemy's favour. It was unlikely that the RAF could resist a long, sustained assault. But the Germans had underestimated the value of British radar, which they thought was primitive, and also dismissed the effectiveness of RAF ground control. They also knew nothing of the work of British code breakers. In the end, it all depended on the bravery and skill of 1,000 or so young pilots, many of whom had come straight from flying schools. The battle raged through the summer, and some encounters were visible from the ground. The attacks on the airfields were the most damaging, and losses were high on both sides. Ground crews worked round the clock to keep the fighters serviceable. A good crew could refuel and rearm a Spitfire in under 15 minutes. Battle-scarred aircraft were patched up and sent back within hours. By mid-September, the battle reached its climax. On September the 15th, Goering sent every available bomber and fighter into battle. Over 600 of his fighters were stationed just across the Channel in France, just 25 minutes flying time away. From early dawn, reports were coming in of great activity across the Channel, but Fighter Command was ready and was expecting the attack in two waves, one in the morning and one in the afternoon. Every last fighter in southern England was committed to the battle. When Churchill asked what reserves we had, he was told there were none. By late evening on that day, September 15th, it was clear that a great victory had been won, and it's now commemorated as Battle of Britain Day.
Thank you. British fighter aircraft in the Battle of Britain broke the teeth of the German air fleet at odds of 7 or 8 to 1. Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.
Spitfire has found a very important part in British history. It's become what's called an icon. It's got a very special place in our hearts in this country. It helped save Britain in Britain's darkest days during the early part of the Second World War.
Operation Spitfire was formed by a small group, passionate and proud of Stoke-on-Trent's contribution to history, and keen to ensure this legacy continues in the future. Historically, Stoke-on-Trent has much to be proud of, not least my great-uncle, Reginald Joseph Mitchell. And the sight and sound of a Spitfire roaring by still triggers a deep sense of pride in me and many others. Spitfire, RW388, was donated to the people of Stoke-on-Trent in 1969 by the RAF as a token of thanks for the city's most famous son. The iconic aircraft was unveiled in its glasshouse on Bethesda Street in 1972, which I attended as a young child. It was the first time I realised how important the Spitfire was to the city. Now, 50 years later on, and thanks to all in Operation Spitfire, we have ensured that this continues in the future.
My name's Corporal Andy Dodd, a member of Operation Spitfire. I've been involved in Operation Spitfire for quite a number of years now, and my current role is an independent advisor to RW388 restoration. Along with Stoke-on-Trent City Council and Medway Aircraft Preservation Society, I've been advised on all sorts of matters and issues that arose during the restoration. RW388, since leaving Hanley, has moved down to Medway. All the paint has been stripped and the aircraft frame has been inspected for corrosion. Luckily, the aircraft was in better condition than we initially thought. On inspecting the aircraft, it was noted that few components were missing. These have since been sourced or are currently being either restored or purchased. So our Spitfire has been repainted, both a prime and a top coat, to represent how she was before. Here you see some of the things that Medway have had to put up with. This here is years and years of paint that was applied to the aircraft. There's about 4 or 5 different paint jobs on this aircraft. So you've got the original aircraft paint on the bottom, followed by a silver coat, followed by the Battle of Britain movie paint scheme, then when it was on the Royal Tournament, and then when it was painted to go back into the museum, and then another paint job that it had later on to spruce it up when it went into the museum in the early 80s. So as you can see, all that paint has had to come off.
So I'm Councillor Lorraine Beardmore. I'm the Cabinet Member for Culture, Sport and Leisure at the City Council, and we're at Potteries Museum and Art Gallery, and we're here to have a look at the works on the Spitfire extension. Things have slowed down a little bit due to COVID-19. We had a bit of a delay when things quietened down and shut down due to lockdown, but things are back up and running now. There was a delay with the building itself and with the Spitfire restoration as well. But things, as I say, are back up and running now, and we're hopeful that we'll get the building and the extension and the Spitfire all open to the public by the end of summer 2021.
Hi, I'm Joe Perry. I'm the Curator of Archaeology and Local History at the Potteries Museum and Art Gallery. This is my video update for Heritage Open Days 2020 for the update video about Spitfire RW388. So It's an exciting time for the Spitfire, obviously. We've made a lot of progress in 2020, despite the rather unusual conditions. The restoration of the aircraft has been continuing, and we're at quite an exciting stage now because the aircraft is being painted up in some of its final colours. So a lot of the aircraft, for a long time, after it was cleaned and stripped by the guys at Medway Aircraft Preservation Society, was this colour. And this is the etch primer that a lot of the aircraft was done in after it had been stripped of old paint jobs. The stripping of the paint was quite interesting in itself. They found a few historic mistakes in the paintwork that had been subsequently painted over. They found a few blobs of brown paint as well, which is a clue from when RW388 was disguised as a Battle of Britain Spitfire. And as part of that disguise, it was painted brown and green instead of the grey and green that the late war Spitfires were usually painted. So quite an interesting job in itself, stripping away those layers of paint. And then, like I say, priming in this colour before being repainted. The reason I have this, and it's not a Medway, this is a clipped wingtip. So RW388 is a clipped wing Spitfire. If I stand back, you can see the full size of that object. Now, the reason we have this and it's not at Medway is because over the years we've picked up a number of spare parts for RW388, and we ended up with three wingtips. And you don't have to be an expert in aeroplanes or aviation to know that you probably only need two wingtips for an aeroplane, at least for a monoplane. So we have a spare wingtip that's been primed and returned to us as a good example of what the pieces look like when they've been stripped. And that background noise, the drilling you can hear, is a reminder that we also have the construction of a new gallery going on. So you might be able to hear drilling and hammering in the background, because where I am in the social history store now is quite close to where the building site is. So we've got various diggers and drills on site, paving the way for our new extension, which again will be opening next year. And that should be exciting. And what I will do now is stop this video, stop talking, and give you a little sneak peek of some of the things we've been purchasing with the help of groups like Operation Spitfire for the new gallery.
So these are some of the cases we've purchased for the Spitfire gallery. They're nice and modular, and the idea is we can get in with them and update them and change them quite regularly to change the objects on display. We've also got the facilities to actually project onto a vinyl sheet along the back of this case to get some archive photographs out, which will be really exciting. And you can see here we've got an interactive touch table, which we'll be putting out in the gallery with some exciting interactive content on as well. And again, you can hear the builders in the background just to prove that something is going on. Of course, there'll also be old favourites in the gallery, as well as the Spitfire. And if we head into the old Spitfire gallery, which is being used as a bit of storage at the moment, you can see we've got those old Merlin engine blocks with areas cut away, and these will be returning to the old gallery to help tell the story of the Spitfire and its famous Merlin engine. You can also see in this area the paper Spitfire that many of you might have seen before the COVID lockdown. This is by an artist called Suhail Sheikh, and he's actually going to be also building a paper hurricane as a kind of a matching sculpture to this one, and it'll be exciting to see that and celebrate both the Spitfire and the Hurricane and the important work they both did during the Battle of Britain. One of the things I thought I could do also was give you a little peek at some of the objects we might be putting inside the gallery. We've got a number of themes to cover, not just the Spitfire itself, but also the story of Reginald Mitchell, and also exploring some of the slightly wider history around the Second World War and its effects on the potteries as well. In this case, we have a Second World War memorial window from Longton. The church it was in was demolished, I believe, and so the window was carefully removed and packed and brought here. And you have various important potteries icons depicted in the window. You've got your Bennetts, you've got your Wedgwoods, you've got James Brindley, and of course amongst them we also have Reginald Mitchell. So we'll be looking at particularly this panel and how we can get that cleaned up and secured and hopefully hung in the gallery as a nice memorial to Mitchell and the work he did. Here we have a rather wonderful model made in metal and wood, and this is of, I believe, the S6B, which was one of Reginald Mitchell's Schneider Trophy winning seaplanes. In fact, it was this, well, not this model, but the seaplane this model was based off is the one that won the Schneider Trophy outright for Britain in 1931, which led Mitchell to be awarded the CBE. It's an amazingly detailed model, and it will certainly be going on display to celebrate Mitchell's pre-Spitfire designs and some of the story of those developments in terms of aerodynamics and engine power and other such things, which you can certainly trace through the Schneider Trophy races and into the development of the Spitfire itself. Here we have a Spitfire fund badge. In fact, this is Spitfire Club Stoke-on-Trent, and these were part of the local fundraising efforts to raise money to build Spitfires. And many towns and cities and organisations across well, across Britain and beyond, actually, throughout the Commonwealth and elsewhere in the world, raised money to build and buy and build Spitfires. And so there are actually two Spitfires known as Stoke-on-Trent 1 and Stoke-on-Trent 2.
There are many things that people feel relate to Stoke-on-Trent and are iconic to us, and the Spitfire is one of those amazing things that is so iconic and everybody can relate to in some way or has a memory of, whether it be they've seen it somewhere or their grandfather was part of something, or it's just really exciting. It's about bringing this to a new era, a new generation of people, and exciting them, installing civic pride in a new generation of Stokies, and it, of course, and the wider country. You know, it's massively important to tourism. Stoke-on-Trent is a great tourist destination, and this is about bringing something new. You know, it's always nice to have something new and exciting, and the council are putting a £6 million capital project into the Spitfire extension, which, you know, shows how important it is to the city of Stoke-on-Trent.
Operation Spitfire has worked with our education partners, from nurseries to universities and all in between, to engage with students, utilising the story of and around the Spitfire to either simply inspire that sense of pride in them or, more hopefully, to ignite the desire to follow a career path in STEM-based subjects.
We've got young people in primary schools having the kind of hands-on engineering experience that we hope will kind of light a flame.
Wow, that's great.
It links, first of all, the primary schools and the high schools, and it's good for the tradition, but also it links the history of the area, and particularly the fact that we've got one of the schools that are here today is named after Mitchell, and that's a particularly nice link.
The opportunity is there for all of you. Engineering is exciting, and I hope by the end of today you can understand why things work.
After this, I've got a placement at JCB doing a higher apprenticeship. And through them I'll be able to become more important of the engineering world and further a career in engineering.
So we're now at 80 years since the turning point of the Battle of Britain, where the skies were filled with planes, and one of those was our wonderful and iconic Spitfire, designed by the fantastic Reginald Mitchell. And now we want to focus on young engineers and young engineers of the future and inspiring them.
Finally, Operation Spitfire has helped to deliver a multi-million pound City Council investment in the Pottery's Museum and Art Gallery. The restored RW388 will be housed in a state-of-the-art glass-fronted new gallery, where the legacy of Operation Spitfire can continue to inspire future generations. I'm immensely proud of my great-uncle, and I'm immensely proud of the achievements of the Operation Spitfire Group.